you plugged in, and we'll discuss all the details when it comes to that. And that is all of the announcements for today. So I got to catch my breath. You know, I was like rambling on and on and on and on. So today we get to do something that I, as a church, before we dive into the sermon, we get to do something today that I don't know if the correct word's ironically, but I was blessed to do this. Tomorrow will be 7 years ago. I was ordained into the gospel ministry. We're going to ordain Jeff. Jeff, if you want to come up. Yeah, Jeff dresses better than me on Sunday. Say, I know. Here's the thing, a few things I want to just communicate, because I know that there's people with different backgrounds here. We are an autonomous church, so the ordination process is left up to the local church, and I have met with Jeff over the last few weeks. A little background on Jeff. Jeff's been in doing some form of ministry for almost 20 years now. He started off in worship ministry. He's worked with College and Career and a few different places like that. He's done some interim pastor work. He has been licensed for over 10 years as a minister. This is the next step. He does not, as far as I know, doesn't plan on leaving. No. No, he's been an elder here at this church and in leadership at different churches before. One of the cool things that's coming up is he's going to be able to work with the organization. PCM, and he's going to be able to get on the college campuses and start some small groups in worship services on Daytona State. Yes, you can clap for that. Work at Daytona State. He's going to start at the campus right over here, wherever we're at, and the one up in Daytona. So I just want to encourage him, and we're going to pray over him. And this is a big step, church. He's being set aside, and we're going to pray over him. And this is a calling on your life. And being a pastor, many times when you take this step, Satan goes out in full attack on your family and things like that. And so as a church, we're going to pray over him. And I just want to, you guys here in a minute, if you want to come down here and just pray over him, it'll be awesome. He's got one of his friends, Mary Jo. She's going to come up and pray first. Then if you want to pray amongst yourselves, and then I'll pray over him. So if I could have someone, one of you, bring up two chairs real quick. You can bring them from the front row if you want to, Dennis. I'm going to have Jeff sit down, and Margaret, can you come up here with him? We're ordaining Jeff. I don't think I told her this, but I'm going to pray over her too, because as a pastor's wife or a minister's wife, my wife does a lot behind the scenes, and she gets attacked just as much, if not more, than I do spiritually. And so we're just going to pray over here. But first, I'm going to let Mary Jo, right?
Yes.
Pray. If you would, come forward if you'd like to pray over Jeff at this time. I want to encourage you. You do not feel obligated. So she's going to pray, and if one of you guys who are close to him wants to lift up, and when we're done, I will close us in prayer as a congregation.
Father, I thank you that according to your word, that the steps of a good man and a good woman are ordered of God. Lord, we lay hands on this couple today and ask that they be instruments of peace, instruments of blessing. We pray a hedge of protection around them. We plead the blood of Jesus Christ over them. We station ministering angels around them. And Lord, I pray that they be peacemakers, that they would let the love of God flow out through them, that they would be a light and salt into the community, and that no harm would come nigh their dwelling. And Father, that they would have an understanding heart. I pray that you would put your heart in Jeff and in Margaret, oh God, in a greater way, so that they would have compassion on those that need to be loved and to be nourished and to brought into the kingdom of God. And Lord, I pray that they will evangelize in this neighborhood. This church will be full and overflowing, booming with the love of Jesus. And I thank you for that, Father God.
If there's anyone like to pray, you can just pray out loud now. I think we can work together when it comes to that. And if not, I'll pray. God, we come before you, Lord, just humbled as a church, just to be able to be part of this celebration, Lord. God, as Jeff is being set aside as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, Lord. God, we just pray that the Holy Spirit pours through him, Lord. Lord, we pray over Jeff that he removes himself from the situation when he is up here preaching, God, and that he is a microphone shouting out the gospel of Jesus Christ, a light that the world can see, Lord. God, and I know you're going to have to lift him up, Lord, in those tough times. And God, you're going to be there with him in those good times, Lord. And God, help him to keep his eyes focused on you, Lord. Lord, we want to lift up Margaret, Lord. Just put a hedge of protection over her. God, as Jeff is going into these new grounds, Lord, God, this is a place that you're going to have to do the battles, the fights, Lord. God, the Bible talks about a battle between not flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, Lord. And God, we know that there's a battle going on between Satan himself and you, Lord. And we know that you have conquered that and you won that. And Lord, and help Jeff to remember that as he is preaching the gospel. Help him never to stray from your word, to preach it in season and out of season, Lord. God, there's going to be a temptation to get up there and preach what he wants to preach. But God, you shine through him. And God, I just pray he stays close to the word. And Lord, I just want to come around and just pray over his son, Christian, Lord. He's going to be a PK now, Lord. And God, we need a hedge of protection over him. Show him your love. Show him your compassion, Lord. And we're just so thankful for Jeff and for this whole family, Lord. And God, I just thank you. Thank you for another man of God who is willing to step out and preach the gospel with no regards to his own life, Lord. And Lord, we lift this up to you in your son's name. Amen. So. All right. Have you got? You can call this a formality or whatever, but just made a certificate here for Jeff. And so just a reminder, I'm going to read the verse on it. So it's 2 Timothy 4, 1 and 2. In the presence of God and Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. And so that's a challenge from 2 Timothy. And we love you, man. So yeah. Yeah. Sorry. I had to get more water before I start preaching. All right, I know we just prayed, but we're going to pray again. This time for the scripture that God speaks to us and works through us. And we're gonna dive through here in the top 10 as a church. So let's pray. God, we come before you. God, I just want to lift up any prayer request. God, I want to lift up those who are physically having ailments, Lord. God, I just want to lift up praises. I want in particular, Norm got to come home yesterday. And God, we're just so thankful for that. And Lord, you're just working these miracles. And God, I know that there's other people with physical burdens or tests that are coming up or anything like that. And they don't know what the outcome may be. But God, we know that you are in charge. And Lord, I just ask that you use me as a microphone to preach your word. God, open up our hearts and our souls and our mind as we dive into your scripture. And Lord, we lift this up to you in your son's precious name. Amen. All right, guys, I'm going to preach as fast as I can. I'm not going to promise you we get out here when we normally do, but we'll have some coffee and cookie back there if you want that. So later on, to tie you over till to the lunch rush. If you are just catching up, we are in our ninth week of this sermon series where we have been going over the Ten Commandments. I don't know about you, but I'm super excited and I've been so encouraged. How many of you have been encouraged? Encouraged. Let's start there. We've been encouraged, right? I think we've all been encouraged. How many of you have been convicted and talking to yourself like, now I've got to step it up? Because that's where I've been, and it's just been refreshing for me as a pastor, and I hope that you're getting the same thing out of it. We have been looking at the top 10 commandments, and we've been focusing on them as Jesus focused on them. And here's the two things Jesus mentions in the New Testament. We're supposed to love God with all our heart, soul, and mind, and then love our neighbor as ourselves. And so when we look at this, and we talk about this, and we discuss the Ten Commandments from that perspective, that's what we've been looking at it as, right? The first four were about our relationship with God. The next six are about our relationship with man. And so we're in the ninth one here, and we're talking about our relationship with man. And so the ninth commandment says this: you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. And here's the question: what does it mean to bear false witness? Because how many of you, when you hear that, you think, it's just talking about we shouldn't lie, all right? And here, we learned this last week, didn't we? That a lot of these commandments go bigger than what we think they are, right? And so when it talks about lying, it's so much more than a big lie that affects one thing. It's part of a heart. It's having the right heart and the right focus and the right relationship with our friends and with our neighbors and with our loved ones. And that's what it's focused on here. That's why it says, it doesn't just say, you shall not lie. It says, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. And so in Exodus chapter 20:16, the Old Testament says it this way. I just read it. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. Colossians 3:9 communicates it this way: do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices. And so when we look at this Old Testament and this New Testament concept that's intertwined through the Scriptures, what it's communicating is this: do not slander, do not gossip, and do not be silent. And I'll elaborate on those three things in a minute when it comes to your neighbor and it comes to telling the truth about them. Because all of these circumference this conversation that says we're not supposed to bear false witness against our neighbor. Now, in the Old Testament, specifically in Exodus, and when you look in Numbers, it's really focused on when you're standing in the court system and you're not supposed to slander your friend, slander your neighbor, slander another Israelite. But that goes beyond that, especially in modern day, especially where we're at now, and especially when you look at how Jesus described this commandment. But I want you to think about slandering. Slandering is just tearing someone down. Like, verbally beating them up, mocking them, whatever you want to look at it. The Bible, in many cases, uses the next term, tell-bearer. I use the term gossip because it's kind of the same concept. The concept is this: you heard that someone making fun of someone, or someone slandering someone, or someone tearing someone down, and instead of going and doing a fact check, what happens? You let it go on. You take it and you communicate it. We see this over and over and over again, especially nowadays, and I think it's even more rampant because we have social media accounts and stuff like that. It's not just the few 50 or 100 or 200 people you hang out with. It can be millions. Things can go, as to use a modern day term, viral, can they not? And so we looked at slander, we looked at gossip, and here's the other one. I wrote down the word silence. And here's the context when it comes to that. A lot of times, we as humans, especially in America, instead of standing up for people who are being made fun of, who are being torn down, who are being slandered, who are being gossiped, just because they might not look like us or talk like us or think like us, we don't stand up for them. In the context here in the Scriptures, it's communicating this: if you're in the courtroom and you hear your friend or you hear one person saying, hey, that person stole something from me, and you know good and well they didn't because they were at your house when they said it was stolen and you don't stand up, that's a lie. Does that make sense? So all of this is talking about bearing false witness against our friends. And so we're going to dive into some scripture passages, and we're going to look at a few different areas. One, we're going to look at what Solomon says about this. Then we're going to look at David, and then we're going to look at Jesus. And those are some three pretty big accounts, right? And wouldn't you say? Solomon, the wisest man. David, a man after God's own heart. And then Jesus, God in the flesh himself, as he communicates, not bearing a false witness against your neighbor. So if you would, look up at the screens, Proverbs chapter 26, verse 18 through 28. This is Solomon. He's describing bearing false witness or lying against your friends. And I want you to see how the wisest man describes lying and how he compares a person who lies and what he compares them to and who he compares them to, because it's interesting. Because a lot of times we let what I call, or I guess what society calls, white lies just go under the table, do we not? And so Solomon, through the working of the Holy Spirit in his life, communicates this in Proverbs. Like a maniac shooting flaming arrows of death is one who deceives their neighbor and says, I was only joking. Did you hear that? Someone who deceives their neighbor and says, I was just joking about it, is like a maniac shooting flaming arrows. That's pretty aggressive, is it not? I mean, put that in your picture, in your head. This is in the Bible. And we don't think about it like that. Remember, keep in your mind, hey, we're looking at these from a different perspective. The verse 19 or 20 says this: without wood, a fire goes out. Without gossip, quarrel dies down. As charcoal to embers and as wood to fire, so is a quarrelsome person for kindling strife. The words of a gossip are like choice morsels. They go down to the inmost parts, like a coating of silver draws on earthenware, or fervent lips with an evil heart. Enemies disguise themselves with lips, but in their hearts they harbor deceit. Though their speech is charming, do not believe them, for seven abominations fill their hearts. Their malice may be concealed by deception, but their wickedness will be exposed in the assembly. Whoever digs a pit will fall into it. If someone rolls a stone, it will rock back on them. A lying tongue hates those it hurts, and a flattering mouth works ruins. So Solomon kind of concludes all those things I talked about here in Proverbs, did he not? I want you to think about this. As I was reading verse 22, it says this: the words of a gossip are like choice morsels. They go down to the inmost parts. And in verse 28, a lying tongue hates those it hurts. In a minute, we're going to look at Jesus and what he says about it, but I kind of want to communicate the concept here. When Solomon is talking about this, he's talking about the heart. He's taking it to the next level. Jesus does that with almost anything, does he not? When he talks about murder, he doesn't just leave it at murder. He says, if you hate your brother, you have murder in your heart, right? When he talks about adultery, if you look upon someone with lust, you commit adultery in your heart. It's the same concept when it comes here with lying. He takes it to the next level. And Solomon is communicating that when he talks about lying or tearing someone down. And here's the concept that's kind of ingrained in this Proverbs. I want you to look at it this way. And this is how the commentators and most of the commentators explain it. It's like this. It's worse for someone to lie or bear false witness against you than to murder you. Because think about it. If you're murdered, what happens? It happens once. It's swift. Hopefully, it's swift to the point, and you're going to spend eternity where you're going to spend eternity at, right? And hopefully you know God, but you're going to close your eyes here for the last time, and you're going to stand before God and the judgment seat of Christ, right? That's what's going to happen. What Solomon is communicating here is this: these lies, these truths go down into the innermost part of who you are, and they don't just end. They can affect you for a lifetime. That's why it's one. That's why Jesus focuses on this. That's why David focuses on this. That's why Solomon. That's why it's one of the Ten Commandments. Because this can affect your relationship, not only with the person who lied against you, but with really all of culture, all of your community, and nowadays all the world, right? How many times do we see a false accusation from one person on another person? It goes viral, and then it turns out that it's not true. And they don't go out, it's not viral that it's not true, is it? It's like hidden in some like obscure little passage down here that you got to scroll. If you're online, scroll like 100 pages down, or if it's in a newspaper, it's on the last page, right? And that's why it's such an important thing for us as believers to lift each other up and to care for each other and not to tear each other down and not to lie to each other and not to slander and not to gossip. If you're part of Ocean Way and you're a member of Ocean Way, one of the things you commit to is not to gossip. Why? Because that can tear a church down too, right? Satan can use that like wildfire to tear a church up. That's one of the things you commit to when you become part of this church, is not to gossip about people. And that's the truth that's here. Now, in a minute, we're going to turn over to Psalms chapter 15, and we're going to look at David's take on lying and David's take on bearing false witness. But before we do that, I want to read from 2 Samuel chapter 6. We don't know for sure, but most people equate that this is probably when David sang Psalms chapter 15, when this whole situation is going on. I'm going to read the first few verses just so you can kind of get your mind around what's happening. And it says, David again brought together all the able young men of Israel, 30,000. He and all his men went to Baalah in Judah to bring up from there the ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord Almighty, who is enthroned between the cherubim on the ark. They set the ark of God on a new cart and brought it up from the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. And I'm just going to kind of tell you the story about what's happening here because of time. But here's what's going on. David is supposed to bring the Ark of the Covenant. If you don't know what the Ark of the Covenant is, this is where God was at in the Old Testament. This is what happened. He would manifest himself in places. He's in the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant would come and be placed back in the day in the tabernacle. In the future, it would be the temple. And this is where the Holy Spirit would manifest it. You hear terms like Shekinah glory. Only the high priest could go past the veil. We don't have to worry about that now. And we'll see in a minute why we don't have to worry about that. Because the Holy Spirit is inside of us now. But this is what's going on. And so as David's bringing the Ark of the Covenant, one of the ox slip and it goes to fall. And one of the guys that are there reaches out and grabs it and then dies. And then David's like, what in the world just happened? He's like, and he gets mad at God. And so he sends the Ark of the Covenant to another city for 3 whole months. Well, guess what happens? God blesses that household greatly. And so David's like, hey, I want it back. And so David comes back. And this is where you hear that story about David dancing around with no clothes on. That's what's going on here. He's super excited. And then he gets chewed out by one of the ladies, because he's like, hey, you're out there half naked. And he's like, I'm out here worshiping God. I wasn't even paying attention to who's around me. He's like, I was worshiping God, but he was the only one that was judging me. And he was the only one watching me because why? The Ark of the Covenant is here. God himself is here in our household. And that's what he's representing. And so while he's going through all of this concept, they say that when David sings, he sings this song from Psalms chapter 15. It says, Lord, who may dwell in your sacred tent? Who may live on your holy mountain? So he asks two questions here. One's kind of got an Old Testament flair. The other one's the future coming when he talks about who can go in your tent. Now they know that only the high priest can go in there. And he's like, well, who is worthy to be in your presence? And then he goes to the next, and when he's talking about this and the tent, the sacred tent, he's kind of talking about temporary things. Because he knows that one day they're going to be on that holy hill, right? And he's like, who's going to spend, or the term like abide, be there for a long, long time, forever? Who's going to be able to do that? And so David goes to sing. And he says, the one who walks in blameless, who does this, who does what is righteous, who speaks the truth from their heart, whose tongue utters no slander, who does no wrong to a neighbor and casts no slur on others, who despises a vile person but honors those who fear the Lord, who keeps an oath when it hurts and does not change their mind, who lends money to the poor without interest, who does not accept a bribe against the innocent, whoever does these things will never be shaken. And so you see this Old Testament vibe, but here's the truth. David's saying, hey, it's all about the heart. And he goes down this list. He's like, don't slander them. And then he mentions a group of individuals, and the story is basically like this. There's a group of men who were working and who were doing a project for someone, and then they realized that it was going to cost them more than what they first anticipated. But to keep up the name of God and to represent God the way they are, they what? They kept their oath. And it's hard to do, is it not? I remember a time in my life. I don't know if some of you have met my brother. He's what I call, he's the one that's 2 years younger than me. So he's the bigger of us all. But he started his own business when he was 15 years old. And it's interesting, as he's worked up and he's gotten through this, and he still does that now. He works for the railroad part-time, and he runs his business. But one of the things he had to learn, he learned the hard way, was making a bid on something and then realizing he was going to spend a lot more money on it than he was, and he ended up losing money on that project than gaining. Now, here's the thing. My dad would always say, hey, you're representing the Deeg name. I didn't know where that truth was till later on, when I was probably 18, 19 years old, that, hey, it came from the Bible. We're representing God. And when I realized that I was representing Jesus Christ, it changed my perspective on how I work out in public. When I worked in the restaurants, some of you might not know this, but I used to work in restaurants. That's how I paid for seminary. I worked in the kitchen. And let me tell you, when you're in there 12, 18 hours, you don't want to finish strong. But I kept telling myself, hey, I'm like the only Christian in here. And sometimes this is the only Jesus they're going to see. And I'm working for Jesus, I'm not working for them. And that's the concept that David's heard. It's all about the heart issue. It's all about representing who Jesus is in your life. And we're going to focus on that a little bit more when we get into the New Testament. And so then we come to Matthew chapter 5. We've got to see what Jesus says about this, right? It says, again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform your oaths to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by earth, for it is his footstool, nor by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Nor shall you swear by your head, because you cannot make one hair white or black. But let your yes be yes, and your no be no, for whatever is more than these is from the evil one. And so here's the truth. I told you earlier that Jesus takes it to the next level, just like he did with murder and he did with adultery. Back in the day, it was encouraged, if you read through Exodus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy and all that, it was encouraged when you made an oath to kind of like put a stamp of approval on it through a variety of reasons. What Jesus says here is, you've heard it's supposed to be done that way, but now that you're a follower of Christ, he says, let your yeas be yea. I learned it this way. Let your yeas be yeas and your nays be nays. And he's saying, here's the truth. Because you are a believer and you're representing Jesus Christ, that fact, that truth about you, people, when they see that, you should only have to go in and say, yes, I can do that, or no. They're not questioning, are you going to get things done? They're not questioning, hey, is this guy trying to pull a sheet over my eyes. You know what I mean? And so that's the truth here. That's the heart behind the issue, is that if you've truly been transformed, if God has come into your life, when people see you, they're going to see Christ shining through you. And so when they come up and they hear you say, yes, I'm going to do that, or no, I'm not going to do that, they know it's the truth. And that goes along with Colossians and what I said earlier. Colossians chapter 3, verse 9, do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices. Each person lying, each person slandering, each person tearing each other down, gossiping about other people, that's what we did when we didn't know Jesus. You hear that, church? That's what we did when we didn't know Jesus. And that's why within the church, this should be a safe place to lift each other up. And when we go out there, we're representing Jesus. And that might be the only Jesus that the world sees in your life. So let Jesus shine. And don't give any question to who Jesus is. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul, he's communicating about letting your light shine. In verse 1, it says, therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And then if you skip down to verse 7, it says, but we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. And so here's the truth, church. Here's the concept, I should say, in this. It is a truth. We once were one way. We once were old. Now we're new. Jesus Christ came into our lives. We're now a shining light. If you come to know Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes into your life. He indwells you, and he is telling others, and you're basically like a lighthouse to those who do not know Jesus. And it's interesting because Paul describes us like this, but we have this treasure. And it's a treasure, right? The gospel of Jesus Christ is what transforms lives. It is the most treasured thing we as humans should have, right? That's how we have a relationship with God the Father, with the creator of the universe. And it's interesting because Paul says and implies that we are like jars of clay. And I want you to think about this. How many of you would take all of your money, all your expensive jewelry, and just put it in a random pot of clay in your house? No, we put it in safes and all that stuff. And it's interesting because God entrusted human beings, and when you get down to it, we're just animated dust balls, guys. We're formed from the dust of the ground. And God entrusted transforming light and power and the Holy Spirit to indwell us and us to preach it out. Why? So he can show his power. Just like, I mean, it's the same concept. It'd be like we putting jewelry in a clay pot, right? And it not getting stolen. And that's the truth here. And it shows how powerful God is. And here's how this ties into lying. And I want you to think about this question. Do my actions communicate a lie about Christ? We as believers, if we truly believe Jesus Christ has transformed our lives, we should want to go out and share it. We should not want to, as the verse says, put it underneath a bushel. Hide it, right? We should want it to shine. Because here's the thing. We're either, one, lying to the world by being silent because we have the truth. I mean, think about this. This is how it falls into salvation. You hear people wondering how in the world and going through grief and how they're going to spend eternity in heaven and what happens after death, and we have the truth and we're just silent about it. So you're either lying that way, or you're lying to, or you don't have the truth inside you, and you're calling yourself a Christian. You're not really a Christian, and that's hard to hear. And that's not my place to judge. That's God's place to judge. But here's the thing. If we're truly a believer, we have been transformed, and we're going to see the fruits of the Holy Spirit coming out. And we're going to be, that shining light's going to be so bright. But so often, what do? We put it under a bushel, right? We hide it. We cover it. We don't want it, for whatever reason, we want to lie about it. And that's why we got to ask ourselves, church, are my actions communicating a lie about Christ? Here's another thing. if we're out in the community and we're picking and choosing who we want to share the gospel with or who we want to invite to church, are we really loving like Jesus? Because God came and died for all. And you get into the Greek word is pos. It has no limitations. He covered all. He died for all, church. The scripture says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That term in there, the pos that's in there, Jesus died for all. He wants that all should come to repentance. And I think a lot of times we as the church are lying about who Jesus is when it comes to our actions, and that's why we hear these terms. I don't want to go to church because there's a bunch of hypocrites there. And the reality is because we're breaking this ninth commandment over and over and over again. Another take home is this. I want you to ask yourself, have I slandered, gossiped, or kept silent when it comes to my neighbor? Have you done this when it comes to your neighbor, your friend, your loved one, whatever's going on? And you got to ask yourself, believer, it's time to say, hey, I messed up. The spiritual word is it's time to repent. If we truly as a church want to see God work miracles, we want to see a revival happen, church, is going to have to come for us to repent and realize that, hey, we have a surface level knowledge of the Ten Commandments, and the scriptures go so much deeper than that. And we got to go live it out, church. That's what we got to do. So you got to ask yourself, hey, what do my actions look like when I'm representing Jesus? And have I slandered, gossiped, or kept silent when it comes to my friends or my neighbors or people I don't know? And what do I need to do different about it? And that's the take home, church. And that's the take home for me. And that's hard because there's things I got to work on. And there's things you've got to work on as a church. If you would, I'd like to ask you all to bow your heads and close your eyes. Some of these sermons are heavy. They lay heavy on your heart. Some of them are hard to hear. But believers, we have a chance now to get back to where we need to be. We have a chance to say, hey, God, I didn't realize that's what you were communicating in the scriptures. Now I know, and I want to live it all out. And I want to encourage you here in a minute to do that. I also want to ask this question. If there's anyone in here who might not know Jesus as their Savior, I want to encourage you to make a decision to follow him today. Maybe this is the first time you showed up at church in forever because you thought Christians were a bunch of hypocrites. But you get here and you hear this word and you hear the truth and you hear the love of Jesus and you hear that, hey, we're trying to do our best and we're trying to allow God to work through us, and maybe you're like, well, hey, it's time for me to take that step, that first step of faith. See, in the scriptures, the Bible says this, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It also communicates this in the New Testament, for the wages or for the payment of sin is death. And if we've all fallen short of the glory of God, and everyone that's a believer in here, we realize that. We realize we've messed up. If we've all fallen short of the glory of God, and we are all have a payment, and that payment is death. I don't know about you, but I don't want to make that payment on my own. But guess what? Jesus made that payment. Jesus came. He lived a perfect life. He died for your sins. The scriptures say he took your sins, and he nailed them to the cross, and when God looks at you now, he sees the blood of Jesus, not our sins. But here's the cool part. Jesus conquered sin and death, and he rose from the dead. And the scriptures say, if we call upon the name of the Lord and believe in our hearts, if we believe this truth, we can spend eternity in heaven. And so I want to encourage anyone that has not proclaimed the name of Jesus to do that today. And you can call upon the name of the Lord and go a prayer like this, and it can go something like this. God, I know I've messed up. God, I've been trying to do it on my own. I've been lying to myself, maybe thinking I could do it on my own, but I realize that Jesus is who he says he is. I want Jesus to be my Savior. I believe he came, that he lived, that he died, that he was buried, but that he rose again. And Lord, I want to spend eternity in heaven because of what Jesus Christ did on the cross. And I lift this up in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you prayed that for the first time, come down and talk to me. I want to celebrate with you. Church, if you're out here and you realize that you've been lying this whole time, I know I had to evaluate that over the last week as I was diving into this. Man, there's a lot more to this commandment than what meets the eyes. And maybe you need to just step out in faith and say, hey, I want to get things right. Maybe this is today, God's just laying on your heart, I want to rededicate to God. I'm already a believer, but I just want to rededicate my life, and I want to get back in church, and I want to get plugged in, and I want to do something for God because God loved me. And so if you would, you can come down here and pray. You can pray in your seats. If you want someone to pray with you, there's a few people in here who would love to pray with you. If you know the words to the song, sing along. But we're going to take a few minutes and just worship God and just commit these decisions that we've made. So.
Great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Well, then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What I could fathom, such boundless grace. The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, well, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have opened every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declare the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declare the grave has no claim on me. Oh, Jesus, yours is the victory. Yeah, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
All right. In a minute, Matt's going to close us in prayer, but if God showed you something today, I want you to give him a big shout out. Yes, aloud. It's been an exciting service. Two things before we close. One, greet Jeff. Tell him you're praying for him. Keep praying for him when we leave. He is an amazing thing going on in his life. Another thing, that we got some stuff out here for the first responders. Pick that up on the way out. And so it's been a great service today. I'm going to let Matt close, and I will be back there in the back.
Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for what you've taught us through your word today. And Lord, we just ask that you would just help us go today. Lord, just help our speech be pure in everything that we do, Lord. And Lord, we just ask that you would just bring us safely to where we need to go today and safely back. Lord, we just ask for traveling mercies along the way. And Lord, we just ask that you would just help us be better neighbors to those around us each and every day. For you, in Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed. Have a wonderful day. God bless.
Thank you. Jesus. Now I think I understand. Electric, the power and the glory just move me.